The U.S., an election rematch never before seen in recent American history, is happening this November. U.S. President Joe Biden and his predecessor Donald Trump both clinched enough delegates for their respective parties' nomination. This follows Tuesday's Republican and Democratic primaries and caucuses in several U.S. states from Georgia to Hawaii. Biden, in a statement issued after the news, took aim at what he called Trump's campaign of resentment, revenge, and retribution. His running mate, Vice President Kamala Harris, also warns Trump continues to pose a threat to American democracy.
And if he is reelected, the former president has openly vowed to carry out, quote, the largest domestic deportation operation in American history. And that is not all. If he is reelected, the former president has openly said he intends to weaponize the Department of Justice against his enemies. He openly talks about his admiration for dictators. He vowed he will be a dictator on day one.
Trump, on his social media platform, meanwhile, vowed to rebuild the U.S. economy he left to Biden in tatters amid the pandemic. The former U.S. leader is facing several legal challenges related to his business and his attempt to overturn Biden's victory in 2020. We're now joined by Professor Jay Batambakal, director of the UP Institute for Maritime Affairs and Law of the Sea. Professor, good afternoon.
Hello, good afternoon, and to all our listeners and viewers, good afternoon.
Okay, we've heard about some of the proposals involving allowing resupply missions to Ayung and Shoal, just as long as large-scale building materials are not brought with them. Fishing in Baho, Masinloc, and other ecological concerns. I'm curious, what were your first thoughts when you heard these proposals coming from the Chinese government?
Well, my first thought, again, is that they're trying to reverse the narrative. As early as 2017, 2018, and 2019, there were already reports about China's destructive activities in Scarborough Shoal, for example, and they were raised at the BCM, and they did not act upon it. And now, if you'll notice in the news reports, they were precisely asking for us to acquiesce to their demands. Mm-hmm. No? They were asking us basically to surrender our rights to Second Tom Shoal, for example. So that's obviously not acceptable. And this is, for me, just another way for them to reverse the story and make it appear that the Philippines has not been acting upon these discussions, when the truth is the Philippines has been raising these issues, and we've gone through so many bilateral consultation meetings that they did not act on our complaints and suggestions.
Is this a strategy by the Chinese government of reversing the narrative? When we heard of this story, China makes it appear that, as you said, the government did not act on these proposals. And aside from that, any action on the proposal by the Philippine government side could have prevented any untoward incident in the West Philippine Sea. Is this a usual strategy?
Well, this has been its strategy for quite some time. Trying to take away, trying to reverse the narrative, really. So, for example, it's been saying that the Philippines has been trying to change the status quo, for example, by sending its resupply vessels to Ayung and Shoal, when the point is that, you know, that has been there for 30 years already. So how is that changing the status quo? See, it's saying that we're the ones undertaking provocative actions when all this time we have been sending the same number of vessels to the same place, to which we've been sending them for, well, since 1999. Mm-hmm. It is the Chinese who are the ones increasing and escalating the situation by sending more and more vessels to interfere with our operation. So how is that? So that's another example of them reversing the narrative. So this is typical, really, I think by now, of their strategy to try to make the Philippines doubt its own position, make the Filipino people doubt their own government and their own decision.
As his reply, we have President Marcos saying that the Philippines has not rejected any proposal, but it's the premise that the country questions coming from the concept papers from China. How do you assess his response, sir?
Well, I think he's responding to the implication being given by the Chinese side and the newspaper that reported it, that the Philippines completely ignored, no, this supposed Chinese proposal. When, as already explained by the DFA, they were, in fact, accepted when they were retrieved, but, you know, accepting as in we received them. No? They were not completely ignored because they were analyzed and they were considered and they were found to be contrary to the Philippines' national interest. Now, what is interesting here is that the Chinese are complaining that we did not act on the supposed proposals after the 8th bilateral consultation meeting. Well, there is documentation which shows that in all the previous meetings, from the 1st to the 7th, the Philippines was asking China for quite a number of things to which they did not respond.
Mm-hmm.
No? Mm-hmm. So this is really concerning, no? That, you know, that even the fact that one of the newspapers here would carry this story without even going through the usual practice in journalism of sort of vetting the information and mm-hmm. checking it or getting a response from the other side.
Mm-hmm. No? Professor, putting aside, if we can put aside the reversing the narrative strategy of China. Just this fact that China presented, 11 concept papers to the Philippines. Does this somehow or in any way give a hint that they do want these issues resolved somehow and that they're giving the Philippines a chance to negotiate or renegotiate?
Well, I think it's clear also from these reports that, yes, they do want this issue resolved, but they want it to be resolved by the Philippines' acquiescence mm-hmm. to their demand,
mm-hmm.
by the Philippines giving up its rights and recognizing their illegitimate claim.
Doesn't that give the Philippine government a chance to offer a counter-proposal?
Well, of course, and that is what these bilateral consultation mechanisms are supposed to be about. Mm-hmm. If the Chinese were serious, since these proposals were given at the BCM meeting, then they should expect a response from the next BCM meeting.
Mm-hmm.
And the setting of those meetings, the schedule of those meetings, is a mutual agreement between the parties. So I don't see why they're complaining now about the Philippines not responding when they have not even agreed to the next BCM meeting.
Mm-hmm. Right, right. Finally, Professor, this act of sending a proposal to the Philippines, these concept papers, do you think that the Philippine government gaining support from other countries for their stand in the West Philippine Sea resulted in these presentation of these proposals?
It's likely because I think everybody can see that ever since the government decided to assert its right and stand by the South China Sea arbitration, more and more countries have been coming to the Philippines, offering aid, assistance, and also giving it moral support. So China needs the Philippines to fold before perhaps the majority of the international community comes to our side. No? So I think that's why it lends a sense of urgency to that. No? They want us to surrender now so that they don't have to deal with more countries later.
Professor Jay Batambakal, we appreciate your thoughts. Thank you very much.
Welcome, and good afternoon.